Questions on Enlightenment. There is a question from Sajid. The question is very interesting. First, he quotes a particular couplet from Kaun Gardeshe Marman. He says, Ghabra na jaye dil, insaan hoon, ghabra na jaye. Ghabrana is a state of elementary state of fear when something new is to happen, unknown is trying to enter. Then you start feeling a sense of insecurity that I don't know what will happen. That state is known as ghabrana. Ghabra na jaye dil, my heart may not feel this pang of the unknown. Why? Insaan hoon, I am a man. Piyala wasagir nahi hoon main, I am not that cup, the container that contains the essential. The essence of the existence. This is somewhat literal translation. Last week you spoke about watchfulness. Is it true that one gets closer? As one gets closer to enlightenment, the path becomes more difficult because of the ego. The person begins to think that he has achieved something. Is watchfulness the key to prevent a person from falling into the trap of the ego and eventually lead him through the arduous path towards enlightenment? This question cannot be answered just so. Because I am not answering this philosophically, I have to respond to this question, and in the way I am responding through Sajid to all those who listen to such broadcast. Few things have to be explained. Yes, it happens when one reaches closer, there is turbulence within. What is going to happen? Whether I will exist as I am? In what form will I exist? When seed for the first time burst into a seedling, there is a turbulence, fear. And that fear is of the unknown. Unknowable, because something of the unknown and unknowable dimension is entering into you. The path is always difficult, whatsoever the path is. You are going to a particular place to meet someone. You are not familiar with the way. Now, as far as the journey is concerned, in the world, there are now GPS systems, routes, and so on. In case of enlightenment, there is no route. Everyone attains to enlightenment in his own unique way. As you travel along the path, a path is created. It is not that there is a path always existing. Buddha's path cannot be yours, or Anand or Atisha's path is not yours. Certainly, the experience of these masters who have attained to enlightenment can help you along the path. It is a journey that you have to do all by yourself alone. So few things are important to know. First, what is enlightenment, and then we go into that. with an example of those who have attained to enlightenment. And in this case, the story of Buddha's enlightenment is very important. It is erroneous to say for a master that I am enlightened. Instead, it has to be said the enlightenment surrounds. When for the first time you experience something of that nature, the magnanimous, you do not have the words to explain. Enlightenment is a total disappearance of ego, desire, and all that is tangible and connected with the mind. Ego is connected with the mind. Desires that I want to be enlightened. Enlightenment is the state of no mind. It is a state when drop has merged into the ocean. Before it merges into ocean, there is turbulence. Jesus was restless while he was going to carry the cross on his shoulders. When he was crucified, the human element was there. Ego is concerned with human element, and human element means mind. The word human comes from humus, the body, and mind. They are a together mechanism. As long as that exists, ego is there. Because of the mind, someone reminds you. Jesus, the human element, is dominant. He complains. Why have you forsaken me, Father? He was expecting as a human being that I will attain to this, I will gain this, that, and so. That is the experience of all those who have attained to enlightenment. It is not like a Nobel Prize given to you, so you have achieved something. It is a state when all that you have considered worth up to now is disappearing from you. Your existence as you have known is disappearing, and you do not know what is going to happen. And the moment something dawns on Jesus and he says, "Let thy will prevail." Before that, he was trying to impose his will. There was a little connection. Jesus continues to complain. That is the human element. But the moment something of the beyond touches him, touches the being, the similar state happened. Buddha had done all that was possible. Everything, that is how the ego goes, the mind goes. By doing this, I can attain to enlightenment. By doing that, all that is important. But then, along the path, that has to be abandoned. Nothing remains. He had become so weak and frail. He was crossing the river Niranjana, which is a shallow, stony river. It was middle of the night, full moon night. The moon was shining in its splendor. Everything was shining, the plants, the river, the stones in the river, the water flowing in between. A thought came to Buddha. My body has become so frail. If at this moment enlightenment happens to me, how can I sustain it? He held on to the tree as he fell in the river that was leaning from the other side of the tree, and he started watching the stars disappear one by one. With that, the mind began to disappear, the thoughts, the desires, all that was known began to disappear. Buddha entered into a new realm. And as the last star disappeared, as the thought came to Jesus, "Let thy will prevail," these two events appear to be different. Up to now, the ego was there. The moment Jesus says, "Let thy will prevail," ego vanishes. The moment ego vanishes, something is born in him and Jesus becomes enlightened. Jesus became Christ. He is no more the son of Mary and Joseph. Buddha is no more the son of King Suddhodan. Instead, he is Buddha the Enlightened. Enlightenment is disappearance of ego, but its presence is important. It gives an impetus along the journey. You realize that you are almost reaching the place. If you are driving a vehicle, there are others who get tired. How long will it take for us to reach there? And you say, "We are just around the corner. Within 10 minutes, we are reaching to the place." And when you reach to the place, you have to hop out of the vehicle. Body is important. Without the body, you cannot journey. But then, just as the vehicle is important to travel, body is important, the mind is important. As long as the body-mind mechanism remains, ego remains. Then, at the moment when the drop is merging into the ocean, the ego has to vanish because the body is disappearing. You are entering into the unknown realm, the realm of the bodiless. You may exist as the body, but you have tasted something of that which is beyond the body. If you have experienced something beyond the body, how can you remain attached to the body anymore? Yes, it is necessary. Enlightenment is the ultimate peak, the flowering. After that, the withering of the flower begins. The moment bud opens up, it becomes a flower. Its withering process begins. It has no more desire to live more. The ultimate has happened. The flower can wither away because it has no consciousness like that of a man. When an individual attains to enlightenment, that is an individual event. But then, if he doesn't continue, how could he help the others along the path? Enlightenment is not a ritual. A question arises: if masters do not speak of enlightenment, how seekers will get the first glimpse? And this far away glimpse is relevant for the seekers along the path. As a result, for your inner search to attain a new impetus, I am speaking to you on various aspects of enlightenment and also the experience of the masters who have attained to enlightenment. Gurdjieff, Buddha, Buddha's disciples Anand, Mahakashyap, Patisha, all these masters, how they have attained to the status of, to the state of enlightenment. Mind thinks like anything else, enlightenment is also a ritual. The moment you make enlightenment ritual, you have moved away from the reality. There are certain things that you have to understand about enlightenment. Very often it is asked if enlightenment is accidental. This is something very significant to understand. Enlightenment is always accidental. You cannot desire for it. It happens, although the journey has to begin with the mind, with the body, but the moment that comes when you realize all your efforts have disappeared, then all of a sudden something springs forth. You are trying to remember a particular name or address or phone number. You put all your efforts. The effort is important to reach to the point where effort becomes meaningless. The more you try to make an effort to remember the name, more futile it is, more tension comes in. The coil is getting bound. And the moment, now out of disgust, you forget. You leave that process of trying to remember the name or the address of the person that you are trying to remember. The mind that has reached to the point, the coil has been bound. Then all of a sudden it begins to rewind. When it begins to rewind, a point comes in. All of a sudden, all that rotations unbind itself. A state of relaxation comes. And then suddenly, something springs forth from within and you remember the name of the person. Your effort, your body, your mind, your ego is very important. Mirza Ghalib says, Ishrat-e-Katra hai darya mein fana hona. This is the ultimate choice of the drop to merge in the ocean. A choice. It is a state of extreme happiness. But before that moment comes, there is a dark moment comes always. What will happen? Whether I will exist as I am now? But then it always happens, you exist that, but something more. It is always accidental, you are making an effort and all of a sudden effort drops and something comes as an accidental state. This does not mean that you do not have to try for it. There is another equally important thing that you have to remember. Certainly your trying is not going to bring it. Your effort is not going to achieve it. But making the effort, searching in all directions, in every possible way, someday it happens. Certainly not because of your effort, but because of your intense urge. A tremendous intensity like a flame within you, but it is always accidental. You cannot say it happened because I did it. Otherwise things would have been very simple. And this is the state, very delicate state, when ego is disappearing into non-ego. The mind is disappearing into no mind. Enlightenment is not a ritual. However, after the master is no more, and also with the passage of time, the inner search becomes a mere ritual. You can look at the Buddhist monks, all are making it a ritual. For example, Buddha sat under a Bodhi tree when enlightenment happened. In every Buddhist monastery, there are Bodhi trees and they are sitting waiting for something to happen, as if Bodhi tree has something to do with it. Certainly Bodhi tree has experienced something magnanimous when flowering happened to Buddha. Buddha had eaten That evening, a sweet made out of milk and rice that is considered to be a very auspicious and important food when it comes to these kind of aspects are concerned. Buddhist monks think that has something to do with enlightenment. So for them, it has become very spiritual food. Sitting for meditation, they eat this particular dish called kheer, the rice pudding, but enlightenment has nothing to do with it. Buddha was sitting in the lotus posture for enlightenment. That was the most comfortable position for him. So every Buddhist monk sits in the same posture. Perhaps the posture has something to do with it, they think. The posture has nothing to do with Buddha's enlightenment, but millions throughout the history have been sitting in this posture, torturing their legs. Rumi danced for 35 hours continuously. In that whirling, he became aware of the unmoving. What is very important in the process of enlightenment is being aware of that there is something immovable within you. All changes take place on that axle. The wheel that carries the axle, it is the axle that does not move, but the movement takes place on that which is immovable. I am speaking to you. This is the experience of the movement. But this movement, where the words are coming from? The words are simply container that carry the energy field that flows from within, from the unknown and unknowable, from the axle. From the center that remains unmovable. But that energy cannot be experienced. In meditation, when energy flows in the form of tawajjuh, then very few are able to decipher that energy. But after the meditation session, the maraqba, the silent communion finishes, comes to an end. Then the master speaks something. It is the energy is being transformed in the form of words, and the words reach you through your ears. It is like the wind that carrying the life particles, the alan vitae, the pranavayu along with it. And it is that alan vitae, that life force that works within you. But you know it only as the air that you breathe in. So whatever is the process, whether it is whirling or Buddha sitting or Jesus on the cross, that moment they became aware of that which remains unmovable, the axle, the center, from where you can move to the periphery. And in order to interact with the people, in order to be of any help to the seeker, you have to leave your center and come to the periphery. And then hold on the hand of the seeker and bring him to the center. When you are in your bedroom, resting, rejoicing, all of a sudden a bell rings, doorbell. You inquire who is there. And if it is someone very near and dear to you, you open the door, held on his hand, and bring him inside. Welcome him, give him an embrace, and offer him all kind of welcome that can be accorded and that is possible within you. For the master, the only welcome that he can do is hold on to your hands, give you an assurance and take you to the center. Center is one. There is only one center, and that center is God. That center is consciousness. And through watchfulness you reach to that center. Watchfulness becomes your diameter, the thoroughfare through which from circumference you move to the center. He brings you to the center. Rumi reached to that center. Reaching to the center is a way of saying he became aware of that which remains immovable. How can ego remain there? Because this experience of the magnanimous can only come when mind is no more in state of deja-vu. You are watching a screen, a scene on the screen. All of a sudden something appears like a deja-vu that you have not been experiencing. You are dazed. Your eyes become blur. You can't see what it is happening. Just there is a tremendous feeling that something is happening. And the moment Rumi became aware of this unmoving, and how he became? Through the watchfulness. Rumi became enlightened. This was the unique way, and unique only because enlightenment happened to Rumi that way. Sitting under the Bodhi tree, enlightenment happened to Buddha. This is another unique way. Only because of Buddha. And now look at the Buddhist monks following this as a ritual. Look at the followers of Rumi. They go on whirling throughout their life like a ritual. In that, certainly they become a great performer, but not enlightened. The world has produced only countable enlightened ones. Because of the human mind, because of the ego thinks that I can achieve it that way. Mind that always shelters in rituals and all that is superficial. So it is not a certain sequence of causes that brings enlightenment. Your search, your intense longing, and your readiness to do anything, all together perhaps they create a certain aroma around you in which the accident becomes possible. Remember, it is not a certain sequence of causes that bring enlightenment. Your search, your intense longing, your readiness to do anything. Buddha did anything that was possible. Whosoever told him that do this and you will become enlightened. He lived on a grain of rice for 6 months. He followed all the rituals that were known by them. But then all those masters were honest enough to say that I only know up to now, this much I know, beyond this I do not know. And they were wise enough, honest enough to say that I do not know more than this. If you happen to know more than this, please let me know as well. The journey of enlightenment is all alone. Just as the journey of the seed is all by itself. The only thing that the gardener does, prepares the flower bed, sows the seed, continue to nourish and nurture with water. Then the existence comes to nourish and nurture in the form of the air, the sunlight, and all that is needed. But its journey is alone by itself. And then lo, the flower has blossomed. The flower's withering begins the same time. Although your search, your intense longing, your readiness to do anything Altogether, perhaps they create a certain milieu, a certain aroma around you in which the great accident becomes possible. Something explodes. If you can see blossoming of a flower in slow motion, you can see how does the inner flower of a Buddha, the flower of enlightenment, blossoms. But you cannot manage it. Every seeker has to begin from the beginning in his unique way. You cannot learn by watching somebody. That is what the religions have been doing. There is a certain prayer, a certain posture, a certain ritual, and a certain way of breathing. Nothing helps. I have loved a small story of Leo Tolstoy from Russia. Archbishop of Russia became very much annoyed because on a small island, three men had come to be known to the population as saints. Now, this is against Christianity. In Christianity, a saint has to be certified by the church as if a saint is a degree, a title. Sainthood is an inner flowering. It is not to be anointed, but in Christianity, sainthood is anointed. In Christianity, a saint has to be certified by the church as if it is a degree, a title. The church has to ordain the sainthood on the appropriate person. The English word saint comes from sanction. When the church gives the sanction, one becomes a saint. Archbishop was very angry that without his sanction, these three people had become known as saints. And thousands of people were going to touch their feet and seek their blessings. Naturally, this was making him very angry. One day he finally decided to go and see what kind of saints these were. He went in a motorboat, reached the island. It was a very small island, only three people lived there. It was early morning, and those three were sitting under a tree. They looked simple, uneducated and illiterate. Archbishop on the way was very nervous about facing the three saints who have influenced thousands of people. But now he saw there was no problem as these looks idiots. He went there and they all touched the feet of the Archbishop. He was very well satisfied. He said, "Do you think you are saints?" They said, "We are uneducated, illiterate, poor people. How can we think such high things? They are not for us. What can we do? People go on coming. We try to prevent them. We tell them that they should go to you. But they do not listen." The Archbishop inquired authoritatively, "What is your prayer?" The three looked at one another and nudged. One said, "You say it." The other said, "You say it." The Archbishop said, "Anybody can say it, there is no harm but to start." They said, "We feel very embarrassed, because it is not really a prayer, but we have made it up." The Archbishop was really angry. "You have invented the prayer? Really? You have invented the prayer? What is the prayer?" One of them said, "If you really insist, we will have to say it. But we are feeling very embarrassed because the prayer is not very great. It is simple. Our prayer is, we are three. We are three. Have mercy on us. Our prayer is, you are three. Father, Son and the Holy Ghost. We are three. Have mercy on us." Even Archbishop in his anger had to laugh. He said, "Great, so this is your prayer." Those poor people said, "We are ready to learn if you teach us the right prayer. We will try it, but it should not be long because we may forget it, or we make mistake, or get confused. Our prayer is so simple we cannot forget it. You are three, we are three, have mercy on us." We cannot make a mistake as far as prayer is concerned. The Archbishop read the whole prayer of the Orthodox Church of Russia. It was too long. Those three people said, "This is too long, please read it again." The third time they said, "Just one time more, so that we can remember it." The Archbishop was happy that these three idiots are no threat. "Now there is no problem. I can convince the people that they know nothing, not even the prayer of the church." They touched the feet of the Archbishop, thanked him and told him that there was no need for him. He should have sent a message and they would come to him. Why should he take such trouble? Anytime he wanted, he should just send a message and they would come to the church itself. Very happy and contented, the Archbishop left. When he was just in the middle of the lake, he saw those three running on the water, coming towards him saying, "Stop, we have forgotten the prayer. Just once more, please repeat." The Archbishop looked at them. They were standing on the water, running on the water. He must have been a man of some intelligence. He said, "Forgive me. Your prayer is right. You continue your prayer has reached, my prayer has not reached. You are really saints. It does not matter whether the church has sanctioned you or not. Sanctions are needed for those who are not really saints. The very existence approves of your prayer. Just forgive me that I interfere in your life." This is a story, a beautiful story by Leo Tolstoy. It is possible with the purity of heart, with serenity of the mind, with the calmness of the being, any word uttered becomes a prayer. Even this becomes a prayer. "You are three, we are three, have mercy on us." The great accident happens. But you cannot copy it. I remembered once another story. Moses was walking around and he was given the responsibility of connecting the people to God. He saw a man, a shepherd. He was taking care of his sheep and he was saying that, "God, I know you are alone and I know very well how difficult it is to be alone. There is no one to take care of you. Let me come and help you. I can comb your hair. I can bathe you just as I bathe my sheep. I can remove all the lice that may fall, that may grow in the hair on the body. I can bathe you, clean you." Moses heard this and he said, "What kind of prayer is this? God and lice, God and hair on the body? What kind of prayer is this man saying? You need to be taught the prayer." So he taught him the prayer. And after that, he walked away happily, saying that he has at least converted one person towards God. As he was walking away, he heard a voice, "Moses, you have taken away one of my beloved disciples. He was my beloved disciple. Moses was startled with that voice that came to him. And the voice said, go and learn from him what the prayer is. Prayer is an expression of inner joy, inner harmony. So is enlightenment, is an expression. And when you are in a state of extreme joy, can you be egoistic? Can a trace of ego be there? But before that it is. And afterwards it will not be, because enlightenment is disappearing of the mind. He is no more servant of the mind. Mind is no more master. Instead, it is a mechanism, just as I am using this mechanism to form the sentences, to form a rhythm, a music, a harmony through these words that are flowing. It is important. When you are extremely happy, or you hear a joke, can ego be there, knowing that your girlfriend, your boyfriend is there, and how will she feel that you are laughing in such an ugly manner? And when you laugh, burst into laughter, how ugly you look. You don't worry about it. You can never remain in a mind. That is why Osho has been given jokes. Some of the masters have used jokes as a method to bring you down from the state of the mind to the state of no mind, from the realm of suluk to the realm of kalp, so that you can create a balance between the mind and the heart. There becomes a bridge between the two. Existence has allowed enlightenment in so many different ways to people. All that we can say is that certain qualities, not very particular method, are needed. Methods are not needed, but qualities are needed. But certain qualities, when they come to meet within you, function not as a cause. Instead, something happens because of their presence. This is what in science is called a catalytic agent. They function as a catalyst. In the process, when two molecules of hydrogen and oxygen interact with one another in the presence of manganese dioxide, you obtain H2O. For example, you know water is made with hydrogen and oxygen, but you cannot mix hydrogen and oxygen and water will not be made. If you divide water, you will find only hydrogen and oxygen. Then what is missing? Why, even when mixing them in the proper proportion, H2O, the water was not happening? For that, the presence of electricity is needed. It does not cause it. It is totally different phenomena than causality. However, its presence is a catalytic agent. Without its presence, oxygen and hydrogen cannot remain together for eternity. But water will not happen. Oxygen and hydrogen can remain together for eternity, but water will not happen. So when you see silver line in black clouds, it is not for the painters and people who understand beauty and are sensitive to aesthetic sense of values. That silver line is nothing but the presence of electricity that transforms hydrogen and oxygen into water. But scientists were surprised in the beginning, because it does not take any part, just its presence is needed. But without its presence, nothing happens. So I can say to you that enlightenment is always accident, not an effect produced by certain cause. Otherwise, things would have become very easy. Everybody could have produced the cause all the necessary ingredients and would become enlightened. This is very important to understand, to grasp completely the question. I am so far, whatever I have spoken is only to give you an idea that you can grasp the question and its response, the answer on its on your own. If lotus posture is needed, he will do it. If it's standing on the head is needed, he will do it. If sitting under the Bodhi tree is needed, he will do it. Anything. If other men have been able to do it, you can. But the problem is, it is not cause and effect phenomenon. So I can describe only a certain presence which functions as a catalytic agent. Meditation creates the catalytic agent within. Create a totally silent mind and no thoughts. A totally relaxed body with no tensions. A totally empty heart with no moods or feelings or sentiments or emotions. And then simply. And when there is no tension, there is no moods, feelings or anything, then ego cannot exist. Then you simply wait. In this silence, in this serenity, you have to wait. And then out of nowhere, something explodes in you. Yes, enlightenment is an explosion. Indeed, explosion of light, love and tremendous bliss, which remains with you forever. And when that has happened, it is a state of madness. You cannot lose it even if you want. Nobody can become an enlightened again. It is not possible. Then ego cannot exist. You recognize the presence of ego. How do you recognize the presence of ego? When someone says, I do this, I did this thing. What else is the way of saying when in Moses' court, Jesus, when God says, I am that I am. Is it an embodiment of ego? No, it is not. It is an expression of inner understanding. Because some kind of word has to be used. Either I use it, I, or I use enlightenment is it surrounds. Along with the word, you have to feel the energy field when the word I is used. I, when it is used, it gives a personalized experience that this person has experienced something. When I have to say something emphatically, I use the second person, I am speaking to you. When something has to be narrated, I use the third person, because that has to be explained that way. So when I was writing the books and these have to be edited, I had to tell my publisher that I would like to speak to the editor. And I explained that this is a person-to-person communion. I am speaking directly to my readers. And when I am speaking to you, I have to use pronoun I and you. If I use the third person, then I will not be able to exert the force that is needed to bring about a transformation in you. I am speaking to you, but at the same time, I keep on using the third person. How? You will simply say, but talk to me directly. Why do you say in a rigmarole way? Then I have to tell you, you have to do this, you have to do that. Because this is my experience. And I am speaking to you on the basis of my experience. Then you understand it better. When the words are spoken, It is the energy field that is flowing towards you. Do you see the trace of ego in me? Ego, in these words, it is simply an expression of the inner joy. And that should be the criteria. The ego does not exist. If ego exists, then that energy force, that tavajjo, cannot have a transforming effect. The words will not have that experience that you feel when there is absence of ego. That is why the words of Jesus, let thy will prevail. This is not a Jesus is saying, instead it is the words of Christ, who is no more the son of Mary and Joseph. Instead, he is beyond. Although he came into existence as the son of Mary and Joseph, but he has experienced something within. He had experienced the center within, that is beyond the control of Mary and Joseph. That is the center he has experienced. And when he says out of that, this world stands the test of time. It becomes eternal. When the sages of the Upanishad say something, Tattvamasi, I am that, I am. Or I am the Aham Brahmasmi. He uses the word I am, the ever-expanding consciousness. He has to use the word I, because I am the ever-expanding consciousness, to give an assurance. You too can attain to that state if you go through the same process that I went through. Moses quote says, God told him that I am, this is the name by which I will always be known. Hindu scripture says, you are that you are. Tattvamasishu. These are the different expressions. The response to that question from Sajid is not over. First, certain things have to be explained, create a milieu, so that the answer can happen within. And then all of a sudden, it begins to take birth within you, and that is the entire process.